जय श्री कृष्ण चैतन्य प्रभु नित्यानंद श्री अद्वैत गदाधर श्रीवासादि गौर भक्तवृंद हरे कृष्णा 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 हरे 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 रामा राम राम हरे हरे
Krishna Krishna Hare 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 Rama Hare Rama 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 Hare Hare
Hare Krishna Hare Krishna 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 Hare 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 Rama Hare Rama 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 Hare Hare
Krishna 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 Hare Hare Hare
Krishna Krishna Hare 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 Rama Hare Rama 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 Hare Hare
Hare Krishna Hare Krishna Krishna
Hare Krishna 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 Hare 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 Rama Hare Rama 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 Hare 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 Krishna 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 Hare 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 Rama Hare Rama 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 Hare Hare
Krishna Krishna Hare 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 Rama, Hare Rama, Rama Rama, Hare Hare.
Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare, Hare Rama, Hare Rama, Rama Rama, Hare Hare,
Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare, Hare Rama, Hare Rama, Rama Rama, Hare Hare.
Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare, Hare Rama, Hare Rama, Rama Rama, Hare Hare.
Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare, Hare Rama, Hare Rama, Rama Rama, Hare Hare, Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna, Hare Hare, Hare Hare Rama, Hare Rama, Rama Rama, Hare Hare.
Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare. Hare Rama, Hare Rama, Rama Rama, Hare Hare. Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare. Hare Rama, Hare Rama, Rama Rama, Hare Hare.
Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare. Hare Rama, Hare Rama, Rama Rama, Hare Hare. Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna, Krishna Hare Hare, Hare Rama, Hare Rama, Rama Rama, Hare Hare.
Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare, Hare Rama, Hare Rama, Rama Rama, Hare Hare, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare, Krishna Krishna Hare 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 Rama Hare Rama 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 Hare Hare
Gopi
Jana Vallabha Giri Varadhari
Yashoda Nandana Braja Jana Ranjana
Yashoda Nandana Braja Jana Ranjana
Yamuna Tiravana Chari
Yamuna Tiravana Chari
Hare Krishna Hare Krishna 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 Hare 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 Rama Hare Rama 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 Hare Hare
Hare Krishna Hare Krishna 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 Hare 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 Rama Hare Rama 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 Hare 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 Krishna Hare Krishna 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 Hare 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 Rama Hare Rama 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 Hare Hare
पावन हरे कृष्ण महामंत्र की
जय।
श्री श्री राधा कुंज विहार श्री श्री गौर निताय की
जय।
श्री प्रभुपाद की
जय।
समवेत भक्त वृंद की कलयुग पावन हरि नाम संकीर्तन की निताय गौर प्रेमानंदी। ओम अज्ञानतमिरन्धस्य ज्ञानाञ्जनशलाकया चक्षुः उन्मीलितं येन तस्मै श्रीगुरवे नमः। नमावों विष्णुपादाय कृष्णप्रेष्ठाय भूतले श्रीमते भक्तिवेदान्तस्वामिनिति नामिने। नमस्ते सारस्वते देवे गौरवाणी प्रचारिणे निर्विशेष शून्यवादि पाश्चात्य देशतारिणे वांछाकल्पतरुभ्यश्च कृपा सिंधुभ्य एव च पतितानां पावनेभ्यो वैष्णवेभ्यो नमो नमः। जय श्री कृष्ण चैतन्य प्रभु नित्यानंद श्री अद्वैत गदाधर श्रीवासादि गौर भक्तवृंद। हरे कृष्ण 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 हरे हरे, हरे राम 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 हरे हरे। हरे कृष्णा, वी वेलकम ऑल ऑफ यू फॉर द वेडनेसडे गीता फॉर ऑल मेडिसी पॉजिटिव थिंकर कोर्स। टुडे आई एम स्पीकिंग ऑन द टॉपिक ऑफ डिसिप्लिन एंड रेगुलेशन। आई विल शो यू द टॉपिक। इफ यू सी हियर दे आर सेइंग दिस वन, या सो इन द पर्सनल हैबिट्स फिफ्थ टॉपिक हियर। You see, rising early, already I have spoken before in Brahma Muhurtam, scientific basis for waking up in Brahma Muhurtam, so we have spoken about it. And keeping physical and mental cleanliness, we have also spoken in one of the previous classes from the Vaishnava Etiquette book, very elaborately about wearing a clean dress and keeping the body clean and everything. So what was remaining was discipline and regulated life. So I heard a lecture from my spiritual master on this disciplined, regulated life, and I will show you that in the beginning, and then we will then watch a PowerPoint after this. Should I make it bigger, or is it big enough? Sufficient? A little more bigger? Okay. Just 1 minute. All right. This he gave way back in 1990, but I found it very profound, very, very much relevant to our topic. So, I took some points from here for making the PowerPoint, but I still found the notes very interesting. So I thought I'll share with all of you. So I'll recite the shloka here.
Raga dvesha vimuktaistu vishayanindriyascharam आत्मवश्यैर्विधेयात्म प्रसादमधिगच्छति।
ट्रांसलेशन, दिस इज 2.64 भगवद्गीता।
But a person free from all attachments and aversion and able to control his senses through regulative principles of freedom can obtain the complete mercy of the Lord.
Yeah. So, he is quoting this famous verse where Krishna says, Raga Dvesha Vimuktaistu. Our attachment to wrong things and aversion for the good things, one should give it up and one should restrain one's senses and mind and by vidhis, by discipline. And prasadam adhigacchati. Then he will get the mercy of the Lord. So this purport I will read later, it will come in the PowerPoint, I'll show you. The beginning Maharaj speaks about need of discipline. He talks about yama and niyama. Yama are the don'ts and niyama are the do's, which are prescribed. For all of us devotees, very simple prescription Rupa Goswami has given. Anukulyasya sankalpa, pratikulyasya varjanam. Whatever is favorable for Krishna consciousness, accept it. Whatever is unfavorable, reject it. One more thing we could say. Whatever is favorable for Krishna consciousness, accept it no matter how much painful it may be. Like rising early in the morning may be a little painful. Chanting all 16 rounds in the morning may be a little troublesome. But no matter how painful it is, if it is favorable, accept it. Similarly, going to satsanga regularly. And also staying in touch with devotees always. And reading Prabhupada books daily, at least half an hour, 1 hour. So all these things may pose some difficulty due to our lack of time or due to our other services and other activities and all. But one should do these things because they are anukul, favorable for advancing in spiritual life. And pratikulyasya varjanam means something is not good for us. At any cost, it should be rejected, no matter how pleasurable it may be. For example, sleeping on a winter season with a covered blanket till 6 o'clock or 7 o'clock may be very pleasurable, but still a devotee gives it up. He'll rise early in the morning and take a bath and get ready and come in front of the Lord and chant. No matter how pleasurable it may be, if it is not favorable, we reject it. So that's the point here. So we all need a discipline in our life. And then he goes on to say, why we need discipline? People generally feel that why should we be restricted in leading a free life? See, when it comes to, he says that when it comes to school or college studies, they are very disciplined. When it comes to professional life, they go to the company punctually, and because they have to earn a paycheck at the end of the month, they are regulated and disciplined. When it comes to religion, people say that, that we can always wait, and we will do it when we get time. They take it pretty lightly. That's the point he makes here. And then he goes on to give evidences, like Old Testament, he says, thou shalt not kill, and thou shalt not covet another man's wealth. Thou shalt not covet another man's wife. All these things are mentioned in those Ten Commandments. Similarly, in the Vedic tradition also, if you see, Chaitanya Mahaprabhu says, asat sangat tyag, yai vaishnava achar. One should give up bad company of people who will deviate us from spiritual life. One should avoid association of materialistic and sinful people. And one should avoid intoxication, illicit sex, gambling, meat eating and all that. Also, one should not unnecessarily trouble the other living entities, not cause harm to them. Also, we should not do prajalpa, arising from envy and greed. So like that, he says that there are many things, favorable things given for us, discipline for us. One should chant Krishna's names regularly. And we should discipline our mind and senses. So then, like he says here, restrain the senses means I will not do what I am not supposed to do, no matter how much I want it. And I will do what I am supposed to do, no matter how much I don't want it. So later on, he gives nice examples here. For example, he tells about the boxer, Muhammad Ali. Muhammad Ali was friends with some of our devotees. So he told them that if he has to go for a boxing competition, 6 months before the competition, he will stop indulging in sex life for 6 months. Because he says that 6 months, if he remains celibate, then he gets a reflex action for giving punch very swiftly. So people are ready to forego sex life for the sake of winning a match. In the same manner, you will find students who are getting into IIT, you will see how much they slog hard. You know, from 7th or 8th standard nowadays, they start and study for almost 5 to 6 years and to crack the IIT JEE exam. Or boys studying for CAT exam to get into IIMs. Or people studying for the GATE to get into IITs. Or NEET, medical exams and all that. People really slog hard. Don't you think they have a discipline of practically keeping awake whole night, studying so many hours every day? They are just, you know, their eyes are glued to the book, days and weeks and months together. So without a disciplined and persistent and consistent and sincere efforts, they won't be able to crack such competitive exams where lakhs of people appear all over the country. So people are disciplined in job, disciplined in family life, disciplined in studies and everything, but not in religion. He says, people take it very lightly, he says. So then he goes on to give the example of Bhakti Vinod Thakur, who was a very ideal example of a disciplined devotee. Why he is taking his example? Because Bhakti Vinod Thakur was a grihastha devotee with 10 children. And he was a high court magistrate. You know, then Maharaj is asking, many of you may have 1 or 2 children, and you know how difficult it is to manage the children. Isn't it? To pay attention to them, to keep them peaceful and happy, how much it takes energy and time. To maintain 10 children is not a joke. But if one is very Krishna conscious, then all the management of the house is taken over by Krishna very easily. He says when he returns in the evening from the court, Yedina grihe bhajana dekhi grihe te goloka bhai. He is saying, when I return home, all his children were devotees of Krishna. Somebody was playing mridangam, somebody playing karta, somebody is doing kirtans, somebody is worshipping in the altar, somebody is cooking and offering bhoga to Lord. So all the children are peacefully engaged in devotional service. So he says, when I return home, you know, Goloka Vrindavan has descended in my home, he says. So this was his family life, very joyful, happy family life, where everybody was chanting, dancing, and the home was like spiritual world. What about his professional life? You know, the Britishers found that this person is able to handled a job what 10 judges cannot handle. In one day what 10 judges do, this one person is doing. So they laid a railway line leading to his house so that straight away in a tram they can bring him to the court directly from the home. So you can see how much they valued his service, because he was very focused and concentrated. Very intelligent also. So if you see his schedule, you'll be amazed. Night, you know, he sleeps like 1 hour or so. One and a half hours he sleeps. Something like 8:30 to 10 or something like that he sleeps. And 10 to 4 in the morning, he writes books. He wrote over 100 books. Again in the morning, 4 to 4:30 he will take rest. Then get up and chant his rounds. Again he'll take another half an hour rest. So if you see his entire day's rest, you know, it comes to like maximum 3 hours or so. 3 to 3.5 hours max. And that too he sleeps in bits and pieces. And he's turning out a lot of work. Like more than 100 books he published. And he was also replying letters. He started more than 2500 Namahatta Bhakti Viksha type of programs all over Bengal. Sitting in Godrum Dweep, he was managing all of it very nicely. So very highly accomplished personality. So we can actually take him as a role model in our lives. How wonderful he is managing his family life, his spiritual life, as well as his professional life so nicely. So Tamara is saying here, compare yourself to Bhakti Vinod Thakur. How many children do you have? He's asking. Maybe 1, 2 or 3 or maybe 4. Can you have more than 5 children in the room? How difficult to train them nicely. So he was able to manage that very powerfully. And the reason he says here, read the yellow one, Lord.
The Lord empowered him by simply to show that if you become advanced in spiritual life, you become most effective.
Effective.
effective and efficient and whatever.
Effective it is.
Effective and efficient.
You become effective and efficient and whatever you do, but there is a difference. You will do it with love, not with greed. The problem in this world is because people are spiritually undisciplined. They do not know how to control, have control over their senses. They do not know how to control their mind. They do not know how to say no to the things that they want to do that are bad. They do not know how to say yes to the things that they don't want to do that are good. And therefore their motivation in their practical life is simply selfishness and greed. When you learn to control and learn to control your mind and your senses, then your mind and senses become peaceful. And in that peaceful state, the love of the soul for Krishna can manifest. So here Maharaj is bringing out a great secret for all of us. He is saying that what was speciality of Bhaktivinoda Thakur? His senses and mind were controlled. He was called as a seventh Goswami. You all know six Goswamis. He's got seventh Goswami. So his mind and senses were under control. Because of that, he had the determination to decide, this is good for my spiritual life, I'll do it at any cost. My mind cannot say no. And this is bad for my spiritual life, discard it. So in this way, he had the concentration, focus and determination, one-pointed efforts. So because of which he was very successful in time management as well as, you know, managing life successfully. So the root point Maharaj is saying here that we have to become disciplined in our life. Therefore the topic for today is discipline and regulation. So then he goes on to talk about the control of the mind. He quotes the verse that, you know, when your mind is clear, you simply see through clear water of your mind and you can see Krishna there. But if your mind is uncontrolled and the senses are uncontrolled, then it will be very difficult for us to make progress. So, one more point he is making here, that discipline means sacrifice. Like you see, an animal is unregulated. A human can be regulated. And when a human being practices regulated devotional service, he comes to a liberated platform where he is divine. I will tell you more about it when I go to the slideshow. So, he goes on to say that the animal is simply concerned with satisfying the sensual demands and mental demands. He cannot understand the philosophy or discriminate and all. You know, if a dog feels like mating with another dog, it goes in the street. It has no control. Or if he feels like sleeping, he sleeps. He feels like eating any dirty thing, he eats. So that is Godas, he says. But Goswami is one who controls his desires and mind desires, And then he says in our life, you see, when our senses say, oh, I want to go to the cinema. If you say, I will not go to the cinema, then you are a Goswami, he says. Similarly, he says, you see the billboard, and there are people who are, some man is embracing a woman and another fellow is having a knife or a gun. What kind of movies they show, But if one sees the billboard and gets fascinated and helplessly gets pulled into the movie theater, and that means he's Godas, he says. Similarly, you see a restaurant where some fragrant food smell is coming. It is not prasad, but somebody is dragged into the restaurant to go and eat. Then he's Godas, he says. But somebody says, no, it is not good for my spiritual life. I won't eat out anywhere and everywhere. So then one is Goswami. Like the simple examples he gives. And then he says a very interesting point in conclusion. He says that, you know, how to control and discipline our mind and senses? Simply saying, no, it will not work, he says. We can't endure for a long time simply denying them. So, and then he quotes, Param Drishtva Nivartate. By getting a higher taste, we can give up the lower taste. Like if you get a big Mahaprasad plate, you can throw away the dry roti of yesterday. But if there is nothing with you, then dry roti is very important for you. Especially when you are traveling, you may eat sukha roti, dry roti. But when you have fresh, nice big plate of Mahaprasad with varieties of prasadam, then you will give the dry roti to a beggar or somebody, something like that. So when you get a higher taste, you give up the lower taste. Isn't it? And then he quotes two examples, Vishwamitra and Haridas Thakur. So Vishwamitra, you know, he still had lingering lower taste. He had not yet got higher taste, so he fell prey to Menaka, he says. And then Haridas Thakur had higher taste of chanting Hare Krishna, so he could very easily give up the lower taste of the prostitute sent by Ramachandra Khan, trying to allure him, allure Haridas Thakur to fall down. Even after 3 days, she couldn't make him fall down. Rather, he converted her into a devotee of Krishna. So in this way, Maharaj goes on to say that discipline involves positive engagement, he says, in Krishna consciousness. Simply denying, no, this is Maya. If you have to give up Maya, you have to give Krishna. Without giving Krishna to our mind and senses, we cannot give up Maya, not possible. Like Vishnu Chakradara gives a nice example. For example, say, you have a knife in your hand and you are also very angry, you can misuse it. But if you hold a bunch of flowers in your hand, then the knife won't be there anymore. So you can only have either knife or an axe in the hand, which is harmful. But if you take a bunch of roses to give to somebody, then knife is thrown away. You can't hold both the things in one hand. It's not possible. So therefore you will find when you take Krishna consciousness in your hands, in your life, then Maya is driven out. So that is a very beautiful verse which says, Krishna Surya Sama Maya Haya Andakar Yaha Krishna Taha Nahi Maya Ra Adhikar. It is said, where there is Krishna like the sun, the Maya like darkness cannot exist. You will never see sun and darkness existing together. You will never find. As soon as sun comes, darkness is driven out. In a dark room, switch on the tube light. Immediately all darkness is driven out. So that's the solution. So we have, how do we attain discipline? Discipline is not a kind of, the three monkeys, don't speak bad, don't see bad, don't hear bad. That kind of shutting the senses is not enough. You have to give positive engagement to senses. You should allow the eyes to see beautiful deity forms. And you should allow the ears to hear Srinmatam, Swakata, Krishna, Punyashravana Kirtana. We should hear Krishna Katha with our ears. Then we get elevation and purification and elevation. Similarly, with the mouth, we can taste delicious prasadam and we can chant Hare Krishna with the mouth. With the hands and legs, we can enter seva. In the temple, we can clean the temple, we can cut the sabji, we can make garlands and offer to Lord. One can fill up one's day with so many services to Krishna. And such a positive engagement will divert our mind away from Maya's engagement and purify us and elevate us, because it's all offered to Krishna. So that's a solution. Therefore, this is a concluding point, that discipline means to please Krishna. Discipline is not just artificial restraint of our mind and senses without positive engagement. Discipline means trying to please Guru and Krishna. In fact, one should not even bother about when am I going back to Godhead. Rather, one should ask, how can I please Krishna and Guru? So when we please Guru and Krishna, when they become happy with us, they bless us, then immediately you will find, mind and senses will be easily controlled. Like here he is giving an example. Read this one. Therefore,
a true devotee will never accept any credit for anything. He understands that whatever spiritual progress are made, it is only by the mercy of Krishna and the mercy of great saints. Krishna's mercy comes through their guru and the sadhus. But we have to learn how to receive that mercy. The process of receiving that mercy is expressing our sincere desire through our action. It's just like many of you are parents. If a child does not try to get good grades in school, will the parents think he is serious about school? What if the child says, Mummy, I really want to please you and I really want to go to the school, but I will not do homework and I will not go to the school.
The child says like this, oh, Mommy, I love you very much. No, I actually want to go to school. I want to give the test. I want to do the homework. But I never go to school. I never do the test, never do the homework. So you may kindly not be unhappy with me. If a child says, mother will say, what kind of love is this? You are talking big, big things, but you are not doing. Same thing Maharaj says in spiritual life. Similarly, if you want to please God, you have to be willing to perform sacrifice. We have to show to Krishna that we want to please Him. Krishna is giving us some rules and regulations. Somebody says, Prabhu, I am breaking all the rules and regulations. There are many people who say that. Prabhuji, I am watching dirty things in the internet. Prabhuji, I am getting up at 10 o'clock in the morning. Prabhuji, I am eating out in hotel, different places. Prabhuji, my old friends are dragging me to go to movies, I am going with them. And then they are asking, so what do you think, Prabhuji? What do you think? You are in Maya, that's all. And that means we are not following what Krishna is saying. So then will parents be happy if a child is not going to school, not doing the homework? He is simply bluffing that he is loving. There is no love. Real love means, really, if you really want to please him, you will be willing to sacrifice anything to please him. Krishna will see our sincerity. How much are we willing to discipline ourselves to say yes to the things that he wants us to do, and no to the things that he does not want us to do? No matter what we think, no matter what we like, you can't say, I like this, I like. No. We have to follow what Krishna is ordering us to do. That's the meaning of Sarva Dharman Parityajya Mamekam Sharanam Braja. He's saying, surrender to me. Because we cannot advance in spiritual life on our own. But if you please him, he will protect us and he will elevate us. Yeah. He says that, Prasadam Adigachati. You will get my mercy by following my order faithfully, you get my mercy and you'll become peaceful and happy. In this way, we can hear the Krishna Katha, we can render Krishna Seva with our body, mind and soul. In this way, so like we said, no pains, no gains. So like for example, for a mother to beget a child and raise a child is not an easy thing, it's a painful thing. But she does the sacrifice and therefore the child loves the mother and the child is eternal. I mean, all his life he is grateful to the parents, isn't it? So therefore in the same manner, Krishna becomes eternally grateful to those devotees who faithfully follow his instructions. And they say a strict no to things which Krishna has told no. And they are ready to pay the price to do the right things which Krishna wants them to do, the right things. So now I will show you the PowerPoint now. So now you have got the summary of this thing which is prepared. This will go very easy for you now. You're showing this one? Yeah. So what we did till now, Maharaj actually told three shlokas if you remember. One was Ragadvesha Vimuktaistu, Vishayan Indriyasharan, Matma Vishayar Videyatma, Prasadam. The word Prasadam means not only Prasadam that we eat, it is also mercy. Krishna's mercy comes in our life when we follow this principle of discipline and regulation on things which he tells us to do. So, like in this picture you see here, this devotee is saying, keep aside all your technology and meditate on the holy names of Lord Krishna and feel ecstasy and bliss. So, his laptop, he has kept it aside, you see. and he is chanting the holy name with great absorption. That's required. Many of you may be working from home now. So there is a lot of office work to do and homework to do. So one has to find out exclusive time for chanting. That is called discipline. You have a discipline. Similarly here you see spiritual master is telling the disciple, you accepted me as a spiritual master, you study the Vedic literature, Gita Bhagavatam, and do the austerity of rising early, chanting holy names, hearing Srimad Bhagavatam every day, and do sense control, and then attain spiritual knowledge, and then you meet Radha and Krishna by chanting Hare Krishna, and eventually meet them. And those people who don't follow the regulated lifestyle program that Guru has given, it's not a very difficult program if you are sincere. Prabhupada has made spiritual life very easy for us. And Shri Gauranitai are the most prominent deities of Radha, of Krishna and Balaram in this age, and they are very, very merciful. They are giving a process which is Kevala Ananda Kanda. It's like a tasty fruit. Chanting, it's like Prabhupada used to say, you chant and dance joyfully, and then when you feel hungry, you take some prasad. If you feel tired, you take a little rest, again get up, again you chant and dance. Such a beautiful method it is. So Gauranitai are dancing gods. And Radha and Krishna, they are sportive god. Jagannath Baladev Subhadra, they are eating god. So all these three lordships are very beautiful personalities that Prabhupada gave us understanding of so nicely. So, and another picture shows the hell. People who don't follow any discipline, any regulation, they eventually glide down to hell and they terribly suffer there. This is a very famous statement of Srila Prabhupada in the 1.5.25. Yeah, read it.
Without being self-controlled, without being disciplined, and without being fully obedient, no one can become successful in following the instruction of the spiritual master. And without doing so, no one is able to go back to Godhead.
So I call this statement as a DOS command. You know what is DOS command? Discipline, obedient, self-controlled. So these three are required, he says. Then only one can follow the instructions of Guru. And then when you follow Guru's instruction, then you can go back home, back to Godhead, he says. That means going back to Godhead, we have to practice these three things. Disciplined, self-controlled, and obedient to Guru. So this, we already recited this verse. So as you see in the chariot analogy, here the soul is the white person sitting in the passenger, and the driver is the intelligence, and the ropes are the mind, and the horses are the senses. So if you want to control the senses, you have to control using the mind. And you want to control the mind, you have to control by using the intelligence. And how can the intelligence, the driver, be very strong? For that, we need discrimination, viveka buddhi. What is good, what is bad, what is right, what is wrong, what I should do, what I should not do. Then how can the buddhi get that supply of that type of strong intelligence? That comes by study of Bhagavad Gita, Bhagavatam, scriptures. So it is said, the senses can be purified by Rishikena Rishikesha Sevanam, by engaging in Seva. If you do Krishna Seva, senses will become purified. Instead of senses engaging in Maya, they are engaging in Krishna Seva, they get purified. And mind gets purified when we chant Hare Krishna. Intelligence gets purified when we study Prabhupada's books, especially Bhagavad Gita, Bhagavatam and other books. And ego gets purified when we live in the company of devotees. Because devotees give us some feedback, they guide us, they tell us, do this, don't do that. We follow it and then we get purified. Yeah. And soul gets purified by Atma Vidya. By cultivating spiritual knowledge, the soul can completely become aloof from all entanglements. In this way we can purify all our all the things that Krishna has given us. Please repeat this verse. Tani sarvani samyamya yukta asita matparaha vashehi asyendriyani tasya prajna pratishthita. Yeah.
One who restrains his senses, keeping them under full control, and fixes his consciousness upon me is known to be a man of steady intelligence.
Two things Krishna is telling here. Tani sarvani samyamya. You withdraw your senses from wrong engagements, mind and senses, and keep them with under full control of yourself. And then what do you do? Yukta asita matparaha. Engage it in Krishna consciousness, he is saying. So three things you have to do. Restrain your senses from running in the wrong direction. And keep them under your full control. Don't let them loose. And thirdly, use those senses in Krishna's service. Then you are a person of steady intelligence, he says. I heard the story in Mahabharata. Bhima and other Pandavas had gone to one village. And in that village, every day, one of the family members from different families have to send one member of the family for one bakasura to eat. So in the family where they were staying, they were all weeping because one member of the family had to go along with a cartload of food. So Bhima said, "Don't worry, you don't have to go. I will go with a cartload of food and I will take care of the demon," he said. So when he went to the forest, the demon came to eat the cartload of food. Along with that, one more person is supposed to come. And he saw that huge bodied Bhima had come. The demon was surprised. "Who is this fellow, who has come here today?" So Bhima didn't care a fig for that Bakasura demon. Rather, he started eating from the cart. So the demon got wild on Bhima and he came to attack him. So when the demon would come to attack Bhima with his left hand, he would give a punch on the chest of the demon. And the demon would topple and take multiple saucers and fall far away. By the time he resumes himself and gets up and comes back, Bhima will eat little more. another 10 palmfuls he would eat. And then he would come, he would give him another punch, he would give him. So, from this example, you can appreciate what we are learning in this verse. Tani sarvani samyamya yukta asita matparaha. By doing Krishna conscious activities like chanting, hearing, reading, taking prasad, you get spiritual nourishment. And tani sarvani samyamya, and that strength will help you to keep maya away. And that's what Krishna is telling. Please repeat. Tani sarvani samyamya yukta asita matparaha. By this you can vashehiyasya indriyani. You can keep the senses under control easily. Because senses now are going to be engaged in Krishna's service. They won't suffer. Here Prabhupada says the same point. Externally controlling senses is not enough. By artificial process, you have to give them a higher taste, Prabhupada is saying. That's the main thing he says here. So here I am giving you an activity here. Study the situation. And you have to find out what is the urge in each of the situations. And how would you respond positively or negatively in these situations, okay? Here, what is the urge? This is gulab jamuns, On a huge festival day, you get a huge pot of gulab jamuns are kept. Everybody is given one gulab jamun, but you go to the kitchen, no one is around. And it's lying like this. So what are you likely to do? You may bring some dabba and put some 8 or 10 gulab jamuns and close it and take it so that you can consume them one by one, isn't it? So the urge here is the tongue. And the tongue is salivating when you see such gulab jamuns. You want to. So sometimes in case we have no sense control, then we may pick up 10 or 20. Then immediately the leader comes there and then he shouts at you, Prabhu, you know, we have only made limited. Everybody is supposed to take only one. Did you get one? You say, yes, Prabhuji. Please kindly put it back. Don't take it. Because otherwise devotees will fall short of gulab jam. Then, sorry, Prabhuji. And you put it back. So we have to cut a sorry figure. So when we don't have control of the senses, we have to cut a sorry figure. Similarly here, you say you are going home for summer vacation. TV is going on full blast in your home. And the remote is right in front of you, and all other family members have gone here and there. Now you are tempted, and you have ample of time in lockdown. What are you likely to do? Take the remote and try to go to different channels. What is happening here? What is happening there? And while trying to just hop and jump from channel to channel, you stumble across some channel where there is something agitating to the mind. Now what would you do? If something dirty, agitating is seen in some channel, again and again you feel like revisiting the channel, like Ajamila saw one dirty sight. He didn't go away from there. Again and again he was watching that sight. Similarly, one may watch and then look at this fellow, how he was smiling before, now he has become sad, morose now. That means lack of sense control makes us morose, makes us depressed, makes us fallen, makes us become degraded. Because of lack of sense control. I read it.
You are going in a train and almost all the seats are empty. Suddenly a group of young college going girls giggling practically insensitive to your presence. They are seated in seats around you. But how would your heart feel and how would you respond to such a situation?
So generally if you are a boy and some young beautiful girls come and sit on, then you are... You feel that, you know, now I have to tell them who I am. I'm very important. One may think, you may ask them, you're all from which college? And I am from which college? Hi, good morning. One may want to introduce and one may try to make some friendship and try to become familiar and intimate. So there is always a tendency like that. There is attraction between young boys and young girls. Then if one has sense control, one will mind one's own business. You have your book, Bhagavatam, Bhagavad Gita. You open it and you read it. Go on with your Krishna consciousness. So you will see that when we are not controlled in senses, we have to cut a sorry figure sometimes. And sometimes they may say, you know, we are all friends, we are talking something serious, don't interfere with us, they may say. And then one may say, sorry, I will not interfere. You all do what you want. So, therefore you will see here, Haridas Thakur, He is able to control his senses according to his plan. That's the meaning of a yogi, Prabhupada says. A yogi can control his senses and mind according to his plan that he makes. Not that helplessly the senses drag him in the opposite direction. Isn't it? Two examples are given. A self-controlled yogi means like a tortoise. As soon as there is danger, he withdraws all his senses inside. Similarly, I am going in the train. People are all talking prajalpa, useless talk. What I should do? Go to the berth, switch on the light, sit with Bhagavatam, sit with the computer, do some reading, writing, preparing. Completely absorb yourself in such a way that, you know, the outside world stops to exist for you. Isn't it? And that is like the tortoise. You withdraw your senses. And when you go to the temple, there don't be unconscious. You can use your senses with your eyes. You can see the beauty of the deities. Savaimana Krishna Padara Vindayor Vacham Sivai Kunta Gunanu Varnane Karau Hare Mandira Marjanadishu Shutim Chakara Chutasat Kathodaye Mukunda Linga Layadarshane Drishau Tadbritya Gatra Sparshenga Sangamam Ranam Chatat Pada Saroja Saurabhe Srimat Tulasya Rasanam Tadarpite Padau Hare Kshetra Padanu Sarpane. With the legs, one should go to the temple. Shiro Hrishikesha Padabhi Vandane. One should bow down the head in front of the deities. Kamam Chadasye Natukama Kamyaya Yadottamashloka Gunashraya Ratihi. In this way, Ambarish Maharaj conquered all his, you know, desires very easily by using all his senses in Lord's service. That's the point he is saying, like a tortoise. In the temple, you will find sometimes in the entrance, there's a stone tortoise, which is opening his, you know, eyes and head and hands, everything in the temple. But when he goes out, he will keep them in like that. That is one of the ways taught for us, how we should restrain our senses in front of Maya and exhibit our senses in front of Krishna. And then the snake charmer example is given. Why? Because a snake charmer has a playing instrument. And when he plays the instrument, the snake comes under control. Well, there is one Satarganj, Prabhupada says, in North India. In that old building, there were 40-50 snakes. When a snake charmer was called there, he played that. Immediately, all the snakes came out. They came in front of him and started dancing. No, 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 no. Immediately, they will all dance like that. And then he will put a basket and he will call them inside and then he will close the basket. And then later on, he will remove their poisonous tooth, then there is no danger with those snakes. Similarly, Prabhupada says our senses are also like snakes, like our eyes and ears and nose and tongue and skin and hands and legs and everything, genitals and rectum and speech. Five Jnanendriyas, five Karmendriyas. They are all like snakes. Why they are snakes? Like when the snake bites you, one may get the poison and die, isn't it? So therefore, the senses also make us indulge in wrong activities. So what is the tooth? The tooth is the bhogavritti, enjoying mentality. So how do we give up that? So like he is playing that instrument. Similarly, we also are given the Mahamantra. Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare. Hare Rama, Rama Rama, Hare Hare. So when we chant Hare Krishna, repeatedly 16 rounds every day, gradually the senses completely get absorbed. Like when Krishna danced on Kaliya, the Kaliya became subdued. Similarly, chanting Hare Krishna, the senses become subdued. And then, when the senses are subdued, using our Krishna consciousness, we should pull out the fangs or the tooth, poisonous tooth of Bhogavrati, and replace it by Sevavrati. Then our snake-like senses can't cause any harm. In this way, Haridas Thakur had conquered the senses. He was a Jitendriya. He was a Goswami. And he had controlled himself like a tortoise. Therefore, he didn't fall prey to the prostitute. In this, there are many benefits of self-control. It yields you knowledge, good qualities like this. You can endure suffering in life even when it comes. It gives you joy and peace of mind, both in material and spiritual platform. So, these six urges, Rupa Goswami says, are urges to be controlled. There are some urges you should not control. For example, if somebody wants to pass stool, one should not control. It will become very great disease inside the belly. One controls the stool, If one wants to pass the urine, one should immediately let them loose. Urine or stool or nose is, stuff is inside the nose. One should go to the wash basin and blow it off. So these are called mala in the body. This is mala, mucus or stool or urine. They are all mala should be thrown out. But dhatus, no, they should not be thrown out. Like virya, for example, siman is a dhatu. Dhatus are those substances and structures in the body which should be retained in the body, which actually nourish the body, which makes the body very strong and sturdy. And the dhatu should be preserved. For example, rasa, rakta, majja, medha, asti. Like that, the Ayurvedic doctors say 7 things they say. Like for example, one should not, like you have bones in the hand, you don't cut open the hand and throw away the bones, because you need the hand, isn't it? You keep the muscles, you preserve the muscles, you preserve the bones, isn't it? In the same manner, one should preserve the semen also. One shouldn't unnecessarily release it. Of course, it can be released when one wants to beget children and raise them in Krishna consciousness. Unnecessarily, one should not waste the semen, because one will physically feel weak and mentally feel drained, and one will feel guilty sensation. And also, when one is not preserving the semen, then one will find oneself becoming a weak personality. But those who are following the path of brahmacharya, whether in brahmacharya ashram, they follow brahmacharya, brahmacharya and sannyasis, and grihastha ashram also, one unnecessarily does not take the sex life as a playful thing, but one utilizes it for begetting and raising Krishna conscious children, then it is wonderful. So one should divert one's attention to Krishna. By doing that, preserving this dhatu, then in this way the one gets viveka buddhi, vichara shakti, dharana shakti and all that. So one should control the urge to speak, the demands of the mind, the anger, urge of the tongue, belly and genitals, which are in one line. So all these 6 urges, if they are controlled, Rupa Goswami says, you are called Goswami. Such a beautiful, straightforward, simple definition. So here is the activity time. Okay. So we want to know the difference between divine and demoniac. I'll show you some examples. These people, those who are demigods or devotees, they obey Krishna's laws. Demons, they rebel. Like for example, Lord says, take the milk from the cow, drink it, it will nourish your brain tissues and study Bhagavad Gita. And devotees accept. But what demons say? No, we don't want milk. We will cut the cow and eat beef. They do exactly opposite to what Lord says. Selfless service to God and His children. That's what devotees do. But these people, they are selfish, concerned about their own sense gratification. So, whatever I possess, everything belongs to Krishna. That is devotees. I am very grateful to Krishna for giving me so many things. He has given me eyes and ears and a mouth, and He has given me the knowledge to chant Hare Krishna. He has given me Bhagavad Gita. He has given me grains and fruits and cereals. He has given me rainwater. He has given me wind to breathe. And He has given me the earthly flat for me to live. And He is so kind. He is kind Father. So lovingly He has provided us everything. And these are only material goods. Physically, emotionally, intellectually, spiritually. Maya mukta jivarnahi swata krishna jnan atayeva Atayeva Koila Krishna, Veda Puran, it is said. Atayeva Kripaya Koila Krishna, Veda Puran. You know, we are all Mayamukta Jeev in this world. So Krishna has come to give Veda Puran and everything for us. In the disciplic succession, parampara. So we are grateful to Him. But what demons do? Read that.
Everything I possess is earned by my own abilities, skill and hard work.
Like that they think. That is the demons. Look before you leap or think before you act. That is devotee. They will always check, what do Guru Sadhu Shastra say about this? Should I do or not? Whereas demons, what they do?
Just do it.
Here they follow Guru Sadhu Shastra. Here they don't follow. They just do what they want. Manmani. They, according to their own mind, they act. And here they attain Satchidananda, life in the spiritual world. And these guys, demons, actually think about Asu, Ra. Asu means immediately, Ra means Raman. They want immediate pleasures. That is Asura. So therefore we all have a choice whether we want Shreyas, which is regulated life to become liberated and go back to Godhead, or Prayas, unregulated life of sense gratification which makes us glide down. So the purpose of human life and human intelligence is to cultivate Krishna consciousness, you see. What is my sambandha with Krishna, with God, and ultimately, you know, prema bhakti. Three things: sambandha, avideya, prayojan. Sambandha means who am I, who is God, and what is my relationship. Avideya means what I should do to revive that forgotten relationship. And then prayojana means Krishna prema, the love of God. So as you see in the picture here, those who inquire sincerely, like Arjuna is inquiring, and then he attains Krishna's lotus feet. And others are demoted to lower animal-like forms. So one can be an animal or a human. So animal plus, you know, adherence to regulative principles makes one a human. And human plus chanting Hare Krishna makes one divine. So in this way, one can go from animal to human to divine.
Unfortunately, so-called civilized man, not caring for God realization, misuses his intelligence to produce many unnecessary and unwanted things. Example, factories, slaughterhouses, brothels and liquor shops.
Yeah, these are examples of unnecessities. Prabhupada is saying, when there is bountiful harvest, you know, nice drinking water, nice grains, fruits, cereals available, and very beautiful nature with blooming flowers and fruits, then with all these facilities, my man can take from nature natural products which are organic and biodegradable, and he can have an eco-friendly environment and ego-friendly relationships by studying the Shastra. So eco-friendly environment is very healthy for the body. Ego-friendly relationships is very healthy for the mind. And then along with that, when one adds chanting Hare Krishna and study of Bhagavad Gita, then one's spiritual life. In this way, one can perfect one's life and go back to Godhead. Instead, you can see how they are traveling in the train. You see here. Prabhupada's time, Prabhupada said, people travel so heavily, hanging from the train, so dangerous it is. And the factories are, you know, causing air pollution, water pollution, mind pollution, noise pollution, all kinds of pollution. So, there is sinful life, there is pious life and spiritual life. So you all know very clearly what is sinful life, needless to say. But you try to think about what is pious life and spiritual life. Why I am showing this? Because it's very important to know that there are 90% of the people who are religious are pious people. One time, Narada happened to travel around to all the holy places. So he saw in Haridwar there was a huge crowd of people. In Kumbh Mela, there was a huge crores of people. To Rameshwaram, you know, Ikkis Koti Tirtha, there were lakhs of people. And he was surprised. He went to Badrinath, there also a heavy crowd. So then Narada was surprised. He rubbed his eyes and saw, is it Kali Yuga or is it Satya Yuga now? Where am I? And he was very happy. He said, I have good market now because everybody is becoming so godly minded. Saintly and godly, immediately flew to Vaikuntha and went and told Lord Vishnu the news, what he saw. And he asked Lord Vishnu, can you please tell me how many Vaikuntha passports can I give me so that I can bring some people with me? You know, I want Visa to bring them to the spiritual world. So Lord Vishnu smiled at Narada and said, you bring as many as you wish, Narada, no problem. Narada became so grateful. Then he flew back to earth. And he went to all the holy places and asked the people, sir, would you like to come to Vaikuntha? And Lord Vishnu has given me free tickets. Here is a ticket, take it. Come with me, not only for you, your wife, children, everybody can come with me. Would you like to come? People say, no, thank you. We know you are a saintly person, very nice, but we have some work to do. I have set up a new business. I have to make some profits. I have to, you know, make some money. I have to pay back some loans, somebody said. Somebody said, you see, my daughter is getting married in a few years. I have to settle. Once I settle her, I'll be free. Somebody said, I'm setting up a business for my son. Once he settles, I'll come. Somebody was saying. Everybody had some excuse. And nobody had time. Narada was shocked. In all the holy places, lakhs of people, but nobody wants to come back to Godhead. And then at last one man agreed. He said, he will come. And they asked, when are you going? He said, I am going right now. You can come with me. The man said, okay, I'll just pack my luggage and come. But when what is the program? When are we coming back? And when Narada said, we are not coming back, Yadgatva Nivartante, Taddhama Paramamama, once you go there, you never come back. The man heard it and became shocked. Really? Oh, I thought it's a few days program like Chardham Yatra or something. If I have to come, I can't come back, I have to be there only, then I am also not coming, he said. So, what is the meaning of pious person? Pious person means he has a bubble around him. The bubble is called I, me, mine. I am so and so, and this is my family, and this is my business, and these are things which I like. And God also, I can include him in my life. I am not an atheist. Let God, like a boy may say, let God help me to get married to that particular girl, or a girl may say, let God help me to marry that particular boy. Or a boy says that, I am going to temple and ringing the bell, may God give me the dream job which I am thinking of. So, like I find small kids coming here. One day I found 4 or 5 kids in uniform. I asked, little girls, you are all in 2nd or 3rd standard. Do you come to a temple regularly? They said, uncle, tomorrow we have examination. I said, today we have exam. Therefore, we have come to pray to God for good marks. We came. So, it's not only to do with children. Even grown-ups are also like children only. They actually, the pious people generally are eye-centered people. They use God for their purposes generally. And spiritual people, who are the spiritual people? They talk about God's family. Who is Krishna's mother, Yashoda? Who is Krishna's father, Nanda? Krishna's very dear friends like Sridhama, Sudama, Madhumangal, and very dear gopis like Radharani, Lalita, Vishaka. Krishna's very dear river, Yamuna, very dear mountain, Govardhan, Parvat, isn't it? And very dear land of Vrindavan, and very dear animals, which is cows and calves. So the devotees who are spiritual minded, their mind is completely absorbed in what Krishna likes, what Krishna wants me to do, what my guru wants me to do. How can I take out my time and do something for Lord's pleasure? Exactly like a mother who thinks about her child, how can I cook some nice item and give my child? Similarly, devotees think about Krishna. So this is the meaning of this song. Krishna ra samsar karo chadiyana char jivedaya Krishna naam sarva dharma sar. So it is do Krishna ra samsar, which means they put Krishna in the center. Like here you find this devotee family, the Mataji, Prabhuji, they are all initiated devotees. And they see the children, they are taught how to play Mridangam, Kartal, and they are all devotees. For them Krishna is the life and soul. And they revolve around Krishna. They put up festivals at the home, they invite devotees to come and listen to the lectures, they decorate the deities, they feed prasadam to everybody, and they are cultivating knowledge about what is soul, what is Krishna, what is spiritual world, what is material world, who is Lord Chaitanya Mahaprabhu, everything. On the other hand, the pious people, they are mostly 90-95% of the time they are occupied with their own things. Many times we see pious people are busy decorating their bodies, expanding their money, but they are not atheistic people. So the sinful people are called Nastik, pious are called Astik, and spiritual are called Bhakta. Nastik, Astik and Bhakta. So we are trying to become Bhaktas. So we have to cultivate spiritual life. So now how can we discipline our mind with all its demands? Now, in the Ashtanga Yoga, these are given. Don'ts and do's are given. Prohibitions and prescriptions are given. I have spoken about it earlier. When I talked about Dhruva, there I told you Yama Niyama. I told about Ahimsa, Asatya, Asteya, Brahmacharya, Aparigraha, Yamaha. And then Shaucha, Santosha, Swadhyaya, Japa, Ishwara, Pranidhani, Niyamaha. I elaborated there. So in this way, then asanas control the bodily senses. And then pranayam is breathing exercise to calm the mind. Actually, it's a mechanical method of calming the mind, but again the mind will become like a serpent again. It will come again. Therefore, we have to chant Hare Krishna and purify the mind. One student asked the question, oh, pranayam is more easy for me to do than chanting Hare Krishna. Can I give up chanting and do pranayam? No, sir. Because Bhagavatam, there is one verse which says, Yamadibir Yogapatair. Yama and Pranayama and all these things when you do, mind temporarily becomes calm. But the impurity is not gone. So the impurity can only be removed by chanting Hare Krishna. And then Pratyahara means withdrawing senses from wrong engagement. And Dharana means holding the mind on Lord's form. And then Dhyana means intensified meditation on Lord. And Samadhi, complete absorption, oblivious to the outside world. Patanjali explains this. So these are the different... So I will give this PPT to you, you can leisurely go through it. On the other hand, in Bhakti Yoga, it's very easily done. You read it, Prabhu?
The restlessness or fickleness of the mind is controlled when one fixes his mind on the lotus
feet of Krishna. One can fix his mind on the lotus feet of Krishna. Krishna Surya Sama. If Krishna is present in the mind, there is no possibility of being agitated by Maya's influence. Look at this. Villumangal Thakur is so absorbed in singing a song on Krishna. Krishna himself is coming and sitting and listening to his singing. So, similarly, Prahlad is singing and Krishna is watching. So, in this way, such devotees have given their mind to Krishna. But so the problem of fickleness of the mind, many people try to negate the thoughts, create a vacuum, that's not possible. We can only remove all these dirty things from the mind by chanting Hare Krishna. Like here you see, the lady devotees are dancing in Kirtan, in Harinam Sankirtan, men are also playing Mridangam and going outdoor Harinam Sankirtan, about which we discussed last class. In this way, we can give engagements to our senses, our mind, our intelligence, then we will get absorbed eventually. Like here you see, all these great devotees are all absorbed by thinking of Krishna, like Markandeya Rishi, like Bhishma Pitama, Gopis, Hanuman. They're all remembering Lord's Nama, Rupa, Guna, Leela. That's the way to elevate the mind. Now, similarly, eating habit. Like some people get obesity because of eating or junk food. So that urge can be controlled by supplying prasad. Also, we should eat prasad twice a day, thrice a day in fixed timing, not just keep on eating. There should be some self-control in that at scheduled times. So Bhaktivinoda Thakur has given songs. So in the Chaitanya-charitamrita, there's a lot of talk about it. One should not eat too fine foods. Tongue will become uncontrolled. One should not eat too much quantity of food. One should not hunt for tasty foods here and there. A lot of time will go away in that. Therefore, one should keep eating program pretty simple so that one can have a healthy body, then go on. Please read the translation. Jivara lalasayai itivatidai shishnadara parayana krishna nahi pai. Yes.
One who is subservient to the tongue and who thus goes here and there, devoted to the genitals and the belly, cannot attain Krishna.
So you can see the tongue, the belly and genitals are in one line. If tongue becomes uncontrolled in eating too many delicious foods, then the belly demands more and more, then the genitals become uncontrolled. So they are in one line, so one should therefore have moderate eating, mitabhuk. One of the 26 qualities of a devotee is mitabhuk. So Krishna says this, yuktahara viharasya, how to regulate. Read it.
Eat to live and not live to eat. Eat sattvic food, food in goodness.
So now,
no junk food.
So I have shown here, if you see, the sattvic ahar is sweet, juicy and very nourishing. Passion is too bitter or too hot and too dry, too pungent. So, and the food in ignorance is stale and putrid, kept for too many hours. It is rotting. So there are people who eat different type of foods, but for Bhakti Yoga, if you want to do well, we have to, that yellow column, which is goodness, that should be followed. You see, in goodness, it increases the duration of life and purifies our existence. Our mind becomes cleaned by eating such foods. Ahara shuddhav, sattva shuddhi, sattva shuddhav, dhruva smriti, smriti lambe granti nam vipramoksha, it is said. You become bodily healthy and mentally also you become healthy. But the passionate foods, if you see, he's having a gastric trouble because of eating, you know, spicy foods. All diseases are caused by that. And what if ignorance food causes severe pain in the belly, dirty foods? Therefore, one should eat sattvic ahar offered to Krishna. Prabhupada said, you know, even a monkey is a vegetarian. Prabhupada says, so we are not just vegetarian, we are Krishnatarian, he said. Here are examples. Read the examples of goodness food.
Milk products, sugar, rice, wheat, fruits and vegetables.
Yeah.
Source of protein. Split peas, dal, whole, wheat, etc. Source of fat. Milk, butter, cheese.
Yeah. If you eat these foods, you can be very healthy. Don't worry that, you know, if I am vegetarian, will I be strong? The elephant is a vegetarian to give you good company. You know, it can uproot the trees and lift logs of wood, though he's only vegetarian. He's not a meat eater. Also, now you all have heard so many classes. Now you have come to a stage where you can avoid things like coffee and tea also. Because coffee contains caffeine, tea contains nicotine. Both are drugs. Also, cocoa contains cocaine, drug. So one should avoid these things which are in passion, yeah. And red pepper also, yeah. And then, food in ignorance, like, you know, meat and liquor and egg and animal fat, all are very dirty foods. Yeah, I put all of it in one slide here. Yeah, read it, avoid it.
Avoid overeating. Problem, stomach disease. When we desire to eat more than necessary, we automatically create many inconveniences in life.
So what is the solution?
Solution, eat only prasad. Control the tongue by supplying prasad. Observe fasting days like Ekadasi and Janmashtami to restrain the demands of the belly.
Yeah. We have fasting days and feasting days. We can follow that. So we can sleep 6 hours daily. If you sleep at 9, you can get up at 3. If you sleep at 10, you can get up at 4. In case some of you need little more, you know, maybe 6.5 or 7, but not more than 7, because our body doesn't need more than that. We just sleeping too much is something which makes us more lethargic, and tamoguna will increase by that. But our body is a machine which is agreeable that we need rest actually to recuperate and get healthy next day. So our sleeping is also a service to Krishna. Our eating is a service to Krishna, sleeping is a service to Krishna, everything. Similarly, we should always sleep early. You know, sleeping at 9, 9:30 latest is very good. Habit, because you can rise early, take a bath and chant very nicely. You can read spiritual knowledge and it will directly go to your head. You will remember all of it very well. So, also we should keep the goal of life in the forefront, that I want to love and serve the Lord. Other things I can always do, but this is a very important thing. Samsiddhir Haritoshanam. Similarly, read this, yeah.
Change your regulated recreation. Change your environment. Take a break and turn to nature. Visit holy places and hear pastimes of the Lord. Hare Krishna mantra, devotional music can energize our souls.
Yeah, these are not difficult. These are very, very great fun. We are going for yatras with devotees to Pandharpur, Mayapur, Vrindavan. Such a joyful experience. You can visit places close to nature, climb mountains, you know, take bath in rivers, take darshan of the deities, and also get to meet with devotees during lunch, make a circle and talk to devotees, and ask devotees how we can advance in spiritual life. Yatras are wonderful. Also, you can hear very nice Hare Krishna music sung by Bibi Govind Maharaj, His Grace Aindra Prabhu, and many others also like that. Madhav Prabhu and all that. And also, because our life becomes like a routine, you know, the bhago bhago, dauda dauda, run, slog hard. Sometimes taking a break and going with devotees to some natural setting and having some japa retreat or discussing some Gita Bhagavatam with the devotees would be very nice. So these are great recreation. Yeah, and also?
Absorb in studying Srila Prabhupada books, which will be enlivening, enlightening and inspiring experience.
Through such regulated and valuable recreation, you know, our mind and senses become calm, cool, collected. And if you do yogasanas, that actually wherever there are pockets of stress in the body, it dissolves it. Yogasanas are very like Surya Namaskar and things like that. Yeah. Yes?
Honest awareness of opposite sex. Problem. Unnecessary involvement in porn watching.
Here you find all these youngsters are watching. Actually, they do not know they are playing with fire. It's like a small newborn baby playing with a knife and doing like this. They are killing themselves actually by this. Because the more people watch dirty things, all the garbage goes into their head. There was a video by a scientist, he says, when people watch porn, it puts them into a state of excitement of what they will do in future with their partner or something like that. So because of that, too much sensual excitement causes different portions of the brain to burn. So they have shown that in that video also. So it is in our interest that we keep our mind calm, cool, collected by not getting into this kind of dirty habits. And I have spoken about this already, about semen protection. Like here you see this man is helplessly pulled by a woman, you can see that, like a horseshoe magnet. You know, even our Shankaracharya sang one song, he said, Balastavar Krida Sakta, Tarunastavar Taruni Sakta, Priddhastavar Chinta Magna, Parabrahmani Kopina Sakta, he said. He said when one is a small baby, you know, one wants a balloon, one wants a tricycle and all that. And then that fad goes away after some time. When you are a teenage, you are in a dream world. Oh, she is my lover, you know, beloved, I am a lover. And one gets into a romantic kind of thing. And that goes for a decade. Once a person gets married, all that is forgotten. Then one runs after money, 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 money is honey, like that. In this way, these are all passing phases of life. And one shouldn't become infatuated by these things. He says that, but attraction for the Lord and service to the Lord is actually the only satyam, only truth. Everything else will be washed away. At the time of death, you will be here, you will be there, Lord will be there, and the relationship will be there. Everything else which was given to you will be taken away. And with empty hands we go. Therefore, one should not get caught up in this world and get entangled. See, Rig Veda says, Maranam Bindu Patanat, Jeevanam Bindu Rakshanat. You know, death approaches a person who is unnecessarily wasting semen. And once duration of life is increased by preserving the semen, it says, you can see the jubilant brahmacharis, they're happy, they're ecstatic. So when one follows the vrata of celibacy, well, they're free birds, they're joyful. They're simply like children depending on the Lord. So in the same manner, grihasthas can also become free. Prabhupada says in ISKCON, there are men and women who are extremely beautiful, handsome bodies they have. But instead of becoming attracted to each other, they become attracted to Krishna. They both are serving very faithfully, very nicely. In this way, we all should learn the art of, rising our consciousness. Here is a table I have given, you can leisurely go through it. Bhishma gives us advice on how to rise above our lower nature. Like if you want to give up anger, learn forgiveness, he says. If you want to avoid losing money and you want to save money, he says, avoid bad association of people who will waste your money, he says. And he says, you want to give up laziness, dizziness? He says, rise up, he says. Rise up and go for a walk, you will forget your laziness, he says. Like that, many nice things, he says. These things will teach us also discipline and good habits it will teach us. And in controlling our desires, you will see, these are all taught not only for the students and brahmacharis also, even for grihasthas. Men and women should be satisfied within the family. Like Chanakya says, santosha trishu kartavyo swadare bhojane dhane trishu chaivana kartavyo swadhyaya japadane yoho. He says three things you should be satisfied. One should be happy with one's own wife and not look at somebody else. One should be happy with the food cooked at home and offered to Krishna and eat it. One should not eat out in a hotel. And one should be able to spend only with the money what he earns in his pocket. He should not borrow any loans, he says. What are the three things you should not be satisfied? In giving charity, don't be very conscious. Don't be miserly. Give liberally. In chanting Hare Krishna, chant more rounds. Ekadashi days you can chant more. And in swadhyaya, study of scriptures, ocean of wisdom is available in scriptures. Keep on studying regularly, daily, he says. So, this propensity for sense enjoyment causes, therefore Arjuna asked the question, anichannapi varshnaya baladiva niyojitaha, what is impelling me to act foolishly in this world? And it is the lust. Our sense of love of Krishna has become transformed into lust, just like when you put tamarind in milk, it turns into curd, like that. And Krishna says, lust only, Arjuna. Lust means adamant desire for the prohibited things. That is lust. So it's Ajamila's example. So we can, you know, if you are not Krishna conscious, then when you contemplate on the objects of the world, you know, we get dragged away and we have no discipline, no regulation. Everything goes for a toss, like that. Therefore, you have to restrain the senses with the mind and the intelligence. And not be like the unintelligent fish who is greedy to eat something and he got caught. So, one should not get entangled in this world like this because of lust. Rather, one should transform lust into love. Like here you see the Krishna Bhaktas. So when devotees see Krishna as the central object of satisfaction, they become very busy, preoccupied in serving Him. They become happy like this. So you will recite this verse. Lord Chaitanya says, Krishna Bhakta Nishkama Ataye Vashanta Bhukti Mukti Siddhi Kami Sakali Ashanta. He's saying not only materialists, even the impersonalists and yogis are also not happy because everybody has their private agenda for their enjoyment. Devotee has no agenda other than pleasing the Lord. So we are coming to the end now. Actually, in order to learn discipline and regulation, there are many things given in the Shastra, like tapasa, brahmacharyana, controlling the mind, controlling the senses, and giving up, you know, material commodities, speaking above a truth, always keeping the body and mind clean, following the do's and don'ts, with body, minds and words, following silence and gravity and not unnecessarily doing prajalpa, and following dharma very faithfully. With great shraddha, one should practice spiritual life. And then, like that he says, it can clear up our anarthas in the heart, but not completely. Therefore, here you see this, these are the things he is saying. In the Bhagavatam it is said, even after doing all these things, it's like burning the bamboos, but the roots remain. Therefore, if you want to uproot the bamboo tree, so that it won't repeat again, it won't come again, then Rupa Goswami gives this. Very simple practice. Associate with pure devotees. Follow the regulative principles of Krishna consciousness. Engage in seva. Engage in hearing also, earlier we said. Because Krishna consciousness can only destroy not only sinful reactions, even the tendency also it can remove and uproot the avidya, ignorance completely. So, Bhakti Yoga is recommended. We have given examples on what activities we should do to eventually gain discipline and regulation in our life. So then one becomes a Goswami. So let us take some questions now. Okay, Anirudh Prabhu from Pennsylvania is asking, will followers of other religions also be taken to their respective planets where they receive further training on serving the Supreme Lord, even if they do not follow the four related principles? No. Whatever they are told to follow, they have to follow. Actually, in those who are studying Bible, for example, you know, they are like Jesus drinks grape juice. And he distributed bread. Later on, they changed it. Instead of grape juice, they started distributing wine, which is fermented grapes, they said. What's wrong? Which is put under the earth and fermented, but the wine is not allowed because wine intoxicates you and makes you forget everything and makes you characterless. And instead of bread, they started distributing meat, you see. So in this way, you will find if we don't follow the principles given in a particular scripture, then one cannot go to the promised abode because we have to follow the laws of God. Similarly, for Muslims, it is said halal and haram. Haram means you just purchase an animal and eat it. No. Halal means one should take the animal to the mosque and cut some nerve and you bleed out the animal without causing it pain. After the animal dies, Then you cut the animal into 8 pieces. 7 pieces you give in daan, charity. And only 1 piece you are allowed to take it. Then it's called halal. Otherwise, haram. How many people are following it? If they don't follow, then how will they please their God? You see? So, they say we are serving God. So, whether you are Christian or Muslim or Hindu, whoever you be, only if you follow the procedure, then only then can attain perfection promised. Naresh Prabhu is asking. Suppose I am not able to control my senses or follow Krishna consciousness principle steadily. This is because no association or lack of determination. Both are required. I am not sincere, confused. Okay. Actually, in the beginning one may face a certain unsteadiness, but eventually you have to hear. Shravanam is the most important thing. Shravanam is like a hungry man eats grains. He becomes very strong and stout. Similarly, Shravanam will make you spiritually stout and strong. And after that, at home also you can have an altar, rise early in the morning, you know, perform Mangalarti, you can chant and sing Mangalarti, Narasimharti, Tulsi Arti, offer water to Tulsi, sit and chant 16 rounds in the terrace, in a very peaceful setting in the morning, Brahma Murtam time, and read Prabhupada books 1 or 2 hours. I can tell you, anybody in the world can become strong. So you can use whatever determination you have in order to do that, and then your determination will multiply. Dearest was asking, right now I'm at home, mostly I'm in association with my cousins, relatives, family members, and none amongst them is a devotee. Everyone is engaging in TV, movies, mobile games, doing nonsensical things, etc., things like that. But to be with them, sometimes I also have to do that kind of activities, though unwillingly. And suddenly I left, if I left everything, then I'll be like left alone among them. What's your advice? Actually, it depends on how serious you are in your spiritual life. For example, when family members are sitting and watching a serial like Mahabharata, Ramayana, if it is already, you can also watch. But if it is some other serial which is all concocted, speculated, Spider-Man, He-Man, Batman and all that, something like that is going on, or some other movie is going on, you know, you can tell them that I want to go and study. Exactly every day during the TV watching time, you can go and study your college subjects. Tell them that, you know, now classes are happening online. This is my study time. They will say, why don't you come and sit with us and watch TV? Yes, I can watch TV, but don't ask me good marks. If you want a good grade from me, then I have to study now. So, actually, all of us at some point of time, you have to clearly draw a line and show to people, whoever it be in this world, only those who are very strict with themselves, they only can go back to God. In the name of being friendly, you know, yevitika, everybody, I want to keep everybody happy, then you will not be able to attain perfection. Another example I'll tell you. Say you are studying for a competitive exam, like GATE or CAT or something. Your other friends want to hang around with you. Hey, chalo yaar, we are going for a movie. Or, chalo, we are going to Lonavala for a change. And in case you try to please one group, is calling you to Lonavala, one group is calling you to movie. If you are pleasing all the friends, you will not crack the exam. Same with going back to Godhead also. Vishwapur is asking. Our Govinda's restaurant and snack center register in Swiggy, which also serves non-veg, and also they get benefited by our orders. Is there any karma comes to us because we are the cause of their business, and how we should understand? No. See, Swiggy actually is an organization which delivers hundreds of different items, hundreds and thousands of items they distribute. And they are basically like a postman. Correct, no? Postman delivering goods from one place to another. And you are not taking any non-veg from them, and nor are we supplying them any non-veg. And there are other people who are supplying non-veg to them, and they will have to incur karma. We are only using them as a communicator or somebody who takes goods from us and delivering to other people. There is no involvement of any karma at all here, in my understanding, because we have nothing to give and take with them. For example, there are even people visiting our temple who are meat eaters, you know that? And we give them prasadam. You know, do we incur any karma? No. Because they may be meat eaters, but slowly they will give up meat eating over a period of time. There are many students also who were meat eaters before when they were coming for our classes. Eventually they gave up. So therefore, anybody's individual, they have to incur karma for their own individual thing. It is their problem, not your problem. Mahesh was asking, why not Krishna come and tell everyone again what is the easy way to achieve Him? Because of Krishna, world is suffering. Some say, what is the problem for Krishna? What do you think Duryodhana, Dushasana, Shakuni, Karna, they were all watching Krishna eye to eye. Do you think they surrendered? Simply by Krishna coming. In fact, Krishna came as a Shanti Dut. Did they agree his proposal? So it is simply a bluff. Simply a bluff. People say that if Krishna comes, they will surrender. If Krishna comes, what they will say? Okay, Krishna, thank you for your good class. Bye-bye. Now you go back and enjoy with your devotees in the spiritual world and I have my business to do. That's what people will do. Actually, it's a sign of insincerity. People don't want to surrender. They bluff with somebody. Whenever Krishna gives me mercy, I will surrender, people say. But Krishna says, Sarvadharman Paritajya, Mamekam Sharanam Braja, surrender unto me. He says, Aham Tvam Sarva Papebhyo Mokshayishyami. If you chant my holy name, study the scriptures, rise early in the morning, lead a pure life, and I will remove all your sinful reactions, and I will take you back to Godhead where there is no suffering. But if you want to be in the material world, padam padam yatpi padam natesham, at every step there is suffering in the material world. You see in the roads there are automobile accidents. And you go to the hospitals, people are suffering from so many diseases. You go to the college, there is examination tension. Go to the company, there is job tension. Anytime anybody can be laid off. You get into married relationships, you understand husband or wife has some deficiency or has some disease or is quarrelsome. Then people get into problems. Anywhere you turn in this world, there are so many problems. Therefore, padam padam yatpi padam, it is said. So if you are really serious about going back to God, you know, God has already shown enough magic to you. He has made the sun. Did you make the sun? Did you make the moon? Are you causing the rains to pour? Are you creating the grains? Are you creating, the Navaratnas? Are you creating the gold and silver? All the 120 elements in Mandalay's periodic table are all material elements created by Krishna. He doesn't have to show any more magic to you. With all the existing magic, you don't surrender to him, you are never going to surrender. We are simply insincere, that's all. It is simply bluff. Actually, we are suffering because of our own karma only. We have turned away from God. Like if a child is giving up the hand of mother and father and running in the street, a lorry comes in front of him. He is running away, but lorry is coming fast. What he can do? He put himself in danger and then blaming the parents. Actually, parents always want to see him in their safety, but there are enough children, I can show you, who want to snatch their hands away and they want independence and they want freedom. So we wanted freedom and we are suffering. This is said in the Srimad Bhagavatam. Janasya Krishnat Vimukasya Daivat Adharmashilasya Sudukkitasya Anugraha Yeha Charanti Noonam Bhutani Bhavyani Janardhanasya. This verse says, Janasya Krishnat Vimukasya. When the jivas turn their face away from Krishna, what they do? Adharmashilasya. They become religious. And the result is Sudukkitasya. They become miserable with varieties of suffering. So what is to be done? Krishna is so kind, he himself is coming in this world as avatar. He is sending the Bhagavad Gita, Bhagavatam scriptures. He is sending the holy rivers like Ganga, Yamuna, Kaveri. He is sending the holy places like Vrindavan, Mathura, Dwaraka, Dhams and Mayapur. He is sending the devotees to give classes on Bhagavad Gita, Bhagavatam. They are giving classes. He is coming as the granthas like Gita, Bhagavatam, Puranas, Vedas, Upanishads. What more you want him to do? Even after all these things you say, No, all this is all right, but he also should come here. I want to see him. Imagine, for example, if somebody is in Aravada jail in Pune here, he says, unless Narendra Modi comes here and bows down to me, then only I'll agree that he is Prime Minister. If somebody says, is he not a fool? Ask yourself. You think Prime Minister of India will leave everything and come to Aravada jail and say, Salam sir, and I am the Prime Minister, do you agree me? Will he say that? Even a Prime Minister will not do it, why should Krishna do it? Tell me. Shruti Bhopimata is asking, why do they sacrifice horse in Ashwamedha Yajna? Because the horse will be given a human body, a quick promotion. If the horse is not given like that, then the horse may take many, many more lifetimes of animals and birds and aquatic, so many other birds he may take and then he may come to human body. Whereas if that Ashwamedha horse is sent to various places all across the globe as a challenge horse, if somebody captures that horse, then there is a fight with that particular country. Otherwise, everybody agrees that we will not catch the horse. That means they will pay tribute to the king, who will be king of the world. And then that horse, when he is offered in the sacrificial fire, he instantly gets a human body. And then one gets a human body, the soul in the body of the horse will leave the horse body and get an instant human body. And that is considered the success of the Vedic sacrifice. So we have answered all the questions today. We will conclude here. And this topic of discipline and regulation, I will give you both this doc file as well as the PPT. We will attach it. And you all can leisurely go through it. Thank you. Srila Prabhupada ki. Actually, there's one question here. One more question, concluding question. Radhika Madhuri is asking, I am not able to give up watching TV, some dance programs, in spite of having knowledge of Krishna consciousness. Why, Prabhuji? What shall I do? My heart is longing for them. Okay, you can learn dancing. I don't see any problem in learning dancing. See, there are harmless recreation and harmful recreation. Say, for example, you want to learn Surya Namaskar. It's very good to learn. Even in internet, you can go and learn Surya Namaskar, how to do it. Similarly, you want to learn Bharatanatyam, some dance you want to learn. Okay, you can learn, surely. And Bharatanatyam also is actually coming from Krishna only, the 64 kalas, one of the kalas. Then you can learn Yashoda Krishna and you can dance and remind the audience of Krishna. It is possible. So, but if you say that I like the movie dance where the hero heroines are, you know, doing break dance, it's a passionate dance, if you like that, that is not very good, because that is going to increase passion in you and it will make your spiritual life difficult for you. You want to come to Sattvaguna. So you can hear nice Hare Krishna music and you can watch dances like Bharatanatyam or even this Kuchipudi or even the other dances also in India, traditional dances, they are good. Okay? And there is one more, I think. How to be sensitive to others' religion? Oh, definitely we should be. There are more than 25 things I can immediately tell you, common to all the religions. Every religion talks about God as the Supreme. They talk about not committing sin, which is disobedience to God. They talk about service to God. They talk about aligning with the Word of God, which is a scripture. They talk about all jivas to be children of God. They say that, you know, be tolerant, be humble, and also deal with all living beings very kindly and courteously. They say that. And they all give commandments to follow. All the scriptures give. They all talk about loving God. They talk about serving God. They talk about, you know, taking out time to spend time with God through prayer. And they also talk about distributing the message of God to the people of the world who are suffering. And they also talk about the Satan or Maya, the force which actually makes us get deviated or forget God, and how not to fall prey to that. They teach us that. So like this, you can see, these are all common in all religions, you will see that. So, whenever I see a Christian or a Muslim following his dharma well, I feel very, very great joy. And I wouldn't mind dealing with them in a very gentlemanly way, nice way. And if they wish to continue what they are practicing very faithfully, I'll be very happy to see that. It's not that I have to convert them to become like me or something. So they are faithfully following. Like I see, there are so many children in madrasa start from childhood and they grow up. Some of them are very cultured also. Same with Christians also. In their churches, some of them are very faithful followers. What I would say is, they should not practice religion superficially, thinking God to be an order supplier. Rather, they should awaken love for God. And eventually, all the religions will converge at one point. Like the Muslims, when they become very ripe in their practice, they become Sufis. And they worship Krishna and Ram. If you see Christians, they become bride of Jesus, they call it. Which means, when they become very, very pure, they consider themselves like a gopi and Lord like the supreme lover or beloved. So in this way, you will find all the religious people in their finest platform of spiritual realization. They can be most friendly. I don't see any problem. Thank you all. Srila Prabhupada ki, Gaur Bhakta Vrinda ki, Hare Krishna.